All right, everybody, let's give it up for Reuben Yap talking with us about Zerocoin. Yay! Yay! This guy. All
right, man, here you go.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Reuben. I'm from the Zcoin team. And today we're going to be talking about basically how we handle broken cryptography in cryptocurrencies and some of the challenges and lessons we learned from the, you know, catastrophic flaw that was Zerocoin. So, just a bit about ourselves. So we are a privacy coin that actually launched on mainnet in September 2016, and we actually pioneered the practical use of Zerocoin, which is actually different than Zerocash. And it was actually one of the earlier kind of privacy protocols to actually introduce the burden and the mechanism. We're currently using a different privacy protocol that we replaced after Zerocoin called Sigma, and we're currently working on something called the Lattice, which is also being considered by MRL as a possible scaling solution for Monero. We have a team of about 19 people, which, you know, almost more than half are developers, and two researchers, one of which is here, and six who are involved in operations, including me. We're working all around the world, and most of us are full time. So the thing about dealing with bugs in cryptocurrencies are particularly difficult. And the more that you resemble a true cryptocurrency, the more difficult it is to actually deal with it. Like, for example, the first thing is the decentralized nature of these networks. And, like, for example, you know, if you have an app store and there's a bug, you can just, like, push out an update and everyone updates, right? But the key point of, blockchain networks, decentralized networks, is that you cannot force people to upgrade. You only upgrade if you want to. And what happens is that, let's say you cannot just turn on a fix. You need everyone to agree and all that kind of fix to turn on. And it's about convincing not just, your users, but the pools and exchanges to actually update urgently without actually causing panic. It's really important not to cause panic, especially in a cryptocurrency. Now, one of the biggest challenges of open source software is that actually every single release has to be accompanied with the associated code. Meaning, let's say, when I'm fixing the bug, the fix to the bug will have to be committed to GitHub before I can make a release. And that's a real problem, because by committing the fix, I'm telling everyone about the flaw. And that's also a real issue there. The third one is also really bad. It's really hard. Because let's say if you suffer from damage, if like coins are being created out of thin air, those coins are sent to exchanges and bought by innocent people. It is very difficult to say roll back the damage per se, because you have innocent people holding the coins. And we don't have another like Ethereum and Ethereum Classic type of situation. So many times you cannot just undo the damage, and most of the time damage is. So, what are cryptographic flaws? We have to sort of distinguish them from, let's say, software implementation flaws. And a cryptographic flaw is a flaw that happens in the actual mathematics of it. It's not just the software bug in the code, but actually sort of like there's a problem with the building block. And there's been actually many sort of implementation and software bugs, even in Bitcoin. There's been Bitcoin value overflow incident where over 184 billion coins were created out there. That was a software implementation bug. It was in Stellar, Zcoin also suffered it really early on, which was also really bad. Pivax also suffered it as well. And all of these are just pure software implementation bugs. They don't actually go down to the problems in the mathematics. Now, these are some of the examples of what cryptographic flaws, and it tends to happen a lot more to privacy coins because of the, we use like cryptographic mixing of methods. And there was a Zcash vulnerability that was actually live for 2 years since inception, and no one actually really knows right now whether it's been exploited or not. Monero had an inflation bug that thankfully was never exploited, and they could actually tell that was no sort of counterfeit coins being created. And Zcoin, the one that we are talking about today, there was a huge Zerocoin inflation bug in April 2019, and it was actually resulting from a failure in one of the zero knowledge proofs. It actually created about 67,000 coins out of 10. Luckily, that's left 1% of circulating supply. The current supply is like 8 million or so now. But you know, it's still something that we cannot retroactively fix. So just a quick understanding for those of you who are not familiar with Zerocoin. Zerocoin is a privacy protocol that allows you to mint, which is the destruction of the coin, and then the spam, which is the redemption of brand new coins with no previous transaction history. So it was actually like the first application of zero knowledge proofs that used this sort of burn and spam mechanism to provide privacy. And when you sort of compare to other type of privacy mechanisms like coin join or ring signatures, ring signatures and coin join, they're kind of like obfuscating transaction rules, so hiding the crowd. And Zerocoin attempts to try to break the transaction rules between the coins because the brand new coins don't have any transaction links to the previous burn. And there were numerous problems with Zerocoin, and we probably should have looked into it a lot harder. And the original Zerocoin paper was written by Ilias, Tristan Gama, and Matthew Green, which then also wrote the Zerocash paper, which now is the foundation of Zcash. And you know, we were like, when Zcoin first started, we only had one programmer. We started it was like an experiment. And we trusted that these people were like the top cryptographers, one of the top cryptographers in the world. And we kind of trusted it, and that was one of the fatal problems that we had. It was actually rather cryptically written, and certain constructions of the proof, that means it wasn't actually fully described. It was only described in the software library that they created. And that's a big problem because then, it's a very different thing than, let's say, I'm reading through the paper and understand how it all works, rather than going through individual crypto analysis to actually this whole scheme actually work. There's actually no single paper exactly describing the way Zerocoin is implemented in the library, and it requires wading through bits and pieces of other papers here and there. It's not as if we didn't take a look at it, we actually engaged a cryptographer to actually try to find flaws in implementation in the Zerocoin security model, and we actually did find two of them. Which was that allowed an attacker to create to destroy coins of honest users while in transit, and an attacker can actually hijack like redemptions. So let's say if someone creates coins to redeem it themselves, those coins can be redirected to someone else. However, we will talk about this later. It isn't as serious as it seems to be, because to actually pull off this attack successfully, you would actually need to have control of the hash power with more than 51%, and also control of the network to be able to selectively censor transactions. If you're going to control both of this, you have kind of effective control of the network, but we'll talk about a bit more about that later. Now, April 9th, which was Zerocoin, which is the protocol, was hacked, and due to a flaw proof, and coins were actually created out of thinnet. And this vulnerability actually impacted all our projects utilizing Zerocoin addresses. But we were the only ones in the pack. So just kind of like the timeline of the pack, we actually noticed a spike in Zerocoin anonymization transactions. We do monitor the network just to sort of as a safeguard. And usually the problem with privacy opt-in is that generally pickup of such transactions are quite low, and suddenly you see every single block of max number of Zerocoin anonymization transactions, and we were starting to wonder what was happening here. What happened actually was at one point the spends, the redemptions exceeded the burns, and we knew something was definitely not right there, and that's supposed to not happen. And we were actually kind of really stressed. Obviously, we didn't even know where the flaw was, but we knew that something was wrong. We immediately contacted the mining crews that we know to inform them to request disabling of Zerocoin spans. That's not done at the consensus layer. There's a parameter that pools can choose how many Zerocoin spans they want to process per block. And we told them, look, we are actually investigating certain Zerocoin irregularities, can you please reduce this to 0 while we investigate it? Luckily, most of them did, but there were still some unknown pools continuing processing. So this hack was continuing to happen, and we couldn't really stop it because of its decentralized nature. We actually did inform other major projects utilizing Zerocoin of a possible issue. We say, like, there's something that's not right here. We notice more spends than mints. We don't know if you guys are affected, but maybe let's create a working group to see if we can find a solution here. On the 16th of April, because we had actually disabled Zerocoin spends without telling the whole public, but it was already too long, it was already like 1 week ahead, and people were starting to complain, why can't I process my Zerocoin spends? And we had to come out with a public notice that we had asked the pools to disable Zerocoin spends while investigating the irregularities. Now, after 3 days, or actually it's already like 10 days since we discovered the hack, we finally discovered the root cause of the flaw and confirmed that it was actually a cryptographic flaw on one of the proofs. And this was discovered by our own lead developer, Peter Schulev. We did a limited disclosure to the Zerocoin working group to tell people that, hey, this is something that we know. There's definitely something is wrong. We think that everyone's affected, but we didn't want to tell the exact problem yet because we didn't want to give ammunition for this other coins to potentially attack. But we just want to tell you the problem is real. Maybe you want to start looking at it. We are in the midst of patching it, but you might want to keep Zerocoin disabled because at that point in time, other projects such as Pivot had already disabled the Zerocoin protocol. Prior to this happening, they were vulnerable to a different software implementation problem called RAP series attack, and they had disabled the Zerocoin, and we were telling them, keep it disabled for now. They were actually planning to reactivate it, and we told them, look, since you have it disabled, just keep it disabled for a little while longer while we figure out what's happening here, and I think that's what we did. On the 20th of April, the hacker wrote a gloating email to us, like, hey, you know how I do it? We didn't really engage with him too much, just kept him. He actually offered to work for us for security audit, but we didn't really engage with him so much. So on the 24th of April, we actually released an emergency software update which actually disabled Zerocoins at a consensus layer, because remember we only disabled it at a mining pool level and there were still spans getting through those blocks. We only had a two-day window. And we're kind of lucky that we're kind of a small coin, so it's relatively easy to do this now. This is something that we may not be able to replicate in the future as we grow bigger. And once the hard fork came into being, the attack actually completely stopped, and we knew that the total number of damage was 69,000 coins. And the only reason why we knew about the exact amount of damage is that actually if you knew the exact flaw in Zerocoin, you could actually create perfect forgeries. But because the attacker didn't quite understand it, he just kind of like got a symptom of it. And the spans that he created had a certain signature that was slightly inflated in size. And that's why we know there were 69,000 coins being created. Now, what actually happened was when this happened, we did inform the working group. One project actually kind of jumped the gun. I don't know what, for whatever reason, they gonna make their disclosure first before we did it and said, oh, we are not affected. We are immune. Zerocoin is disabled on our network. And that was, to put it to say, that's a bit of a big move because, other projects who had not secured themselves, other projects did not have a mechanism to just disable Zerocoin like that. And this was a real big problem for us because although we had already secured ourselves, all these other projects that were still using Zerocoin did not have a clear way to disable it very quickly. And this actually required us to come up with a different, a quick disclosure to say, okay, this is what's happening, we're not going to tell you the exact details, but we'll let you know, let you guys know later. This is one of the real problems that really kind of hit us really badly. Now, on the 30th of April, luckily, all projects that we were aware of all had disabled Zerocoin either by sports or hard fork. And sports is kind of like, for those that are using the dash master code, they can actually have a sort of development master key that can turn on certain features. So for those coins, they had an easy time with that, just turn it off, which It's great for stopping a hack, not so great for decentralization. And that made a full disclosure of cryptographic vulnerability and made it public. And after that, 2 months later, we finally deployed our replacement privacy protocol that we actually have been actually developing since early 2018. So it was actually in the plan anyway to replace Zerocoin. So what actually did we learn from the incident? And we think there are actually like three key pillars in dealing with cryptographic flaws, which is capability, communication, and caution. And the first thing is that no one wants to deal with other people's shit, okay? Especially on an urgent basis. When a cryptographic flaw happens, you have to act really quickly, and we tried looking for help just in case we couldn't solve it ourselves. We were really worried this could potentially kill the coin. And we reached out to the origin of researchers. Everyone was out busy and didn't really want to touch this problem because it was a real big problem. And I think that's actually a really key differentiator between projects that merely just implement other people's privacy protocols versus those that actually develop it themselves. Like for example, with Zcash, there's so many other privacy projects that use a Zcash privacy protocol. Similarly, there's a lot of projects that use Monero privacy protocol. And sure, they get how it works, but they don't really know the inner workings. And that's really dangerous, because then they rely on whatever the parent project is to make disclosures to them. And sometimes that doesn't really work, as we have seen. And sometimes you really cannot trust everybody. We'll talk about this a bit later, but even cryptographers you engage as a third party can actually screw you over as well, especially if they're just a contractor as well. They can exploit it themselves, or they can publish a technical paper and blow it out of all proportions and gain credit for themselves, which we actually see what actually happened with the burden 0.15 profit paper. Now, disclosure and working together with other projects in competition is very risky, even though we were all incentivized to fix Zerocoin. I mean, our experience with this whole Zerocoin working group was so bad that we were thinking in the future we might not even collaborate, which is very sad, but it's maybe you guys there was a real breach of trust on our head. So you have a carrot ownership. So communications, we have several people that we need to talk to, the community, media, PR, our infrastructure, and the code itself. And to the community, of course, we need to try to be as honest as possible to let people know that there's a problem. But again, we have to stagger the information at least while we fix the problem and, totally sort of lock it down. And we also need to make sure that we're not causing any panic. Oh my god, there's all this speculation about what the thing might be in charge of. Really affect the trust of the project. Now, the thing that's really important is the engagement of media and PR. When something goes wrong, you really need to be proactive, not just reactive. And we made a mistake before where we kind of just reacted to the problem. And in this particular case, when we knew we had a problem, we knew the problem, we straight away reached out to all the media. This is our official press release. This is what it is. If you have any questions, talk to us. And we really wanted to make sure that you got the portrayal of the bug correctly. Now, just to give an example of something that went really wrong. So remember those two bugs that we found previously that were not that critical, which was called burning 0 points for fun and profit. That researcher actually approached all these media and said, I found a critical flaw in 0 point. And the problem was that we had engaged him to actually find this flaw, and we had patched it, which was actually scheduled for activation. And what had happened was, all the news was saying critical flaw 0 point, this thing can't be fixed. And actually, as I mentioned, it is actually really difficult to take advantage of that flaw. So it's really important to just proactively reach out instead of waiting for people to crack you. Now, with the infrastructure, of course, it's always good to look at a decentralized approach. We should be knowing who our main stakeholders are, especially with exchanges and mining pools. And we have to make sure we open good enough communications with that so that when we disable Zerocoin or this is emergency update, at least they trust us enough to take it at our word. It's not the best thing, but we need to have build that relationship up there. And the worst thing, I guess, is through the code. We need to communicate through the code. Remember, every single sort of fix that we put has to be connected to the source code before we can actually make a release. And one way to do it, there are, I guess, two approaches to do it. One, which is the Zcash way, which is basically wait for like a huge update and then sort of sneak the fix in. There's certain like drawbacks to that, because that means you need to be open for a much longer period. Or for us, like what we did, we kind of downplayed the fix. So for example, even Bitcoin did that when they had an inflation bug. They said, oh, this bug, we fixed the bug that solved DDoS, but then actually it was a source of inflation bug. So what we did was to downplay the fix and we committed the code to GitHub so that it doesn't result, like, in result in any sort of panic, but later on we possibly disclose it. So the last one, I guess, is like caution. You know, don't trust verify, even if it's done by the world's best cryptographers or whatnot. And as I said, understanding protocol is quite different than doing a detailed analysis of it. And the Zcoin flow is actually quite tricky for me. The protocol has been around for a long time. You know, people have looked at it, there are cryptographers from different projects looking at it, and no one thought every time it's okay, right? And unless you actually pointed it and stared at it, something wrong there. So it pays to actually really, you know, analyze every single portion of it. Now, don't be in a rush to deploy new technology, especially when it seems much better. I think this is something you know, we have been guilty of. Like, for example, our proof of work algorithm called MPT. You know, there was a new paper out that promised to be better than every hash, more fair, and what happened. And we spent about 8 to 10 months kind of like trying to build this out and develop it. And about 2 weeks before launch, there was actually a paper out that said, oh, MPT is broken, you can attack it in this way. And can you imagine that we just threw like 1 whole year's worth of work? So we had to actually invest in more research to actually fix it. Took another year to, you know, get that paper out and deploy a fix. And I think it's better to actually, rather than, you know, keep on looking at the new shiny things, to wait for the technology to mature before you launch it. I mean, it seems really obvious now, but, you know, when it was like a very competitive environment, what are you doing? What are you doing? It's quite tempting to take on the most like sexy technology. The other thing I would say is that consider using certain breakers and limiters that can slowly relax. So for example, in Zcoin, we actually had a limit of, let's say, like 500 Zcoin per block that could be spent. It's almost like similar to almost like Bitcoin having like a 1 megabyte block limit to prevent DOS attacks. I think it's quite, especially when you're dealing with like such new technology, it's probably wise to have some sort of like limiters in place, and I guess that actually saved us. So that block, we could limit the damage, we couldn't just like create like 1 billion coins out of it. But it's not ideal, and it has to be, you know, it's just one of the many fixes that you could do. But we have to be very, very careful that we're not introducing centralization. Well, I'm actually personally really against spots, because, you know, it's basically the developer who has the key to be able to turn on functionality. And I think especially as a privacy point, that's horrible. If a dev can, you know, like a law enforcement or like a government entity goes to dev, turn off privacy, I think that's a horrible idea. So just quickly, what replaced Zerocoin? We are currently on Sigma, which is based on much better written papers. You know, every single, like, the construction is relatively simple, and every single portion has a security proof. And it works exactly like Zerocoin, except it uses different cryptography, and it's a lot smaller, it's really small proof sizes, and it also does not have trusted setup. So this is already currently deployed on our network, and it's live since like the end of July. The Lattice, which some of you may have already heard, it further expands on Sigma and it eliminates the need for burning and redemption and fixed denominations by actually hiding them up as well. We also have the ability to have direct anonymous payments, that means you don't have to keep on redeeming back to the base layer, but it requires a self-spend, and it's a problem that we're working on, and it's also a problem that if the Lattice is to be ever considered to be deployed in Monero, this is a problem that needs to be solved. So Monero's proposal for the Lattice is kind of different than how Zcoin intends to use it. So I think Monero's, if I'm correct, intends to build like a really large ring. It's like 1,000 or so. The way that this Zcoin is intended to be used is as like a sort of like a similar Zerocoin where we're doing burning and redemption. So it's different approaches but possibly using the same technology. So just a quick comparison, I just spoke that Aaron, there's a bit of errors in some of the proof sizes. So, you know, this is just a sort of like an overview of the different, you know, privacy mechanisms. So as you can see, Monero actually solves most of the issues of the anonymity set size, which is something that's active research. Thing that needs to be corrected is that in Lattice and Sigma, the proof sizes, when you are giving all the proofs, including the auxiliary proofs, the range proofs, is about 3 to 4 kilobytes. You can announce the R later. So it's about similar to Monero, and I think everything else is relatively correct. And you can take a look how bad Zerocoin is when you compare it to other stuff. So yeah, I mean, you can find out more, you know, very active Telegram community. If you want to find out more about Lattice, go to that website. We have a Zoom meeting later on at the website. So yeah, I'll take some questions if anyone has that. Thank you very much. Yes, sir. It's already deployed. Yeah. So right now, I mean, originally we did think about like having the Lattice on in like Q1 2020. But you know, after this incident, maybe we should slow down a bit, and that may be a wise choice. But we do have the cryptographic libraries, as you already know, and hopefully we can share some of that as well. But right now, I would say that we're kind of like packing down Sigma, making sure everything is like, you know, fine and dandy. We also be doing mobile development. But then, I think maybe in about 1 or 2 months' time, the Lattice development really start kicking in. So that's kind of where we are. Yeah, we're already in, you know, great touch with Saran, and we're already open. We actually, you know, agreed privately that we may actually share our source code of what we've done to Saran early on before even making it open source. Okay, thank you very much.